How do you know if a crypto or blockchain project actually provides value? Is Bitcoin really a store of value? And how should you go about diversifying into gold or Bitcoin? Those are questions I'm going to answer for you, so stay tuned. All right, welcome back. Every Monday, I bring you a video where I answer your questions on video. If I pick one of your questions from one of the other videos to be answered in this video segment, you get $10. If your question is the question of the week, you get $50. So make sure to leave your questions on the videos. Hopefully you get picked. Now, the only requirement is, well, maybe there's two. You have to be subscribed to the channel. So make sure you're subscribed before you submit your question. This week's winner is Rich Formoso. He said, powerful stuff, Mark. You're providing an incredible value with this channel. And I promise I didn't pick you just because of the compliment, but thank you. He said, would love to hear more about how to go about choosing a side hustle. I've started a few with limited success. How do you avoid shiny object syndrome? Your question was a very, very highly asked question and commented on question. I'm releasing two separate videos just on this topic. So it was a good question. I've made two more videos just on that topic, so stay tuned. And Rich, if you're watching, make sure to send me a message to claim your money. First question we're gonna answer today is from Kjell Floer. And they said, how would you go about to find out if a crypto blockchain project has value to provide to the market? Your top five ways that you look at that. How do you know if anything provides value to a market, right? How do you provide value to a market? So that question is really summed up in everything, no matter what investment you wanted, even for yourself, how can you provide value? So how do we know if it's going to provide value? So really it comes down to problem and solution. What is the problem that they're setting out to solve? How big is that problem? How many people is that affecting? How much is that needed? Does it have unlimited demand? The bigger the problem that they're solving, the more value it provides. If they're solving a really small problem that probably doesn't need to be solved and it doesn't really affect that many people, then it's not gonna provide a lot of value. If they're solving a massive problem that's a major pain point for everybody, it's gonna provide massive value. That's the way that I look at it. So the very first question I look for, if I'm gonna evaluate any project, any investment, regardless if it's crypto or in any other asset class, is what problem are they solving? How big is that problem? Does it need to be solved? And if I'm looking to provide more value to the market to make more money, I also look for what problem can I solve? And then how big is that problem? So same thing. Thanks for answering that question. Make sure to send me a message to claim your reward. Next question is from Tommy Blanchard. And they said, what would be the counterargument to the idea that a deflationary currency that keeps going up in value discourages people from spending, which is therefore bad for the economy? You have inflationary and deflationary. So like the dollar, they continue to make more dollars, continue to print more dollars, so that inflates the money supply. It's an inflationary currency. With Bitcoin, it's a fixed supply. It's never gonna go above 21 million. So that could be a fixed or a deflationary currency because it's not going to inflate. He thinks it could be bad for the economy because people in college, in school, in college, are learning that we need to always be spending, and deflationary currencies are bad for the economy. So what's the argument to that? So there's two schools of thought, really, that I'm going to break this down into, and these are economics things. There's Keynesian economics, which is pretty much everything that's being taught today. And then there's an Austrian school of economics thought. I know many, many people with economics degrees from lots of different colleges, and they've never heard of Austrian economics. It's pretty much been stamped out of our entire system, because they want us to always be spending. Why? So they can continue to print more money, they can continue to create more credit, so they can continue to enrich themselves, but does it really help us? And a deflationary currency like Bitcoin or gold would discourage it because people would wanna save it instead. I would highly recommend anybody to study some Austrian economics, go to Mises.com, you know, search it on YouTube, whatever, there's lots of different videos there. Basically, I think it's a fallacy that we need to always be spending. Wealth is created through capital. So when I work extra and I save, and now I can deploy that capital to work, That's what creates wealth. It creates assets, it creates businesses, it solves problems. Spending by itself does not. I'm spending on a bunch of things that I don't need, that aren't doing anything, aren't solving anything, and at the end of the day are not worth anything. If I'm saving and I'm deploying capital, it's gonna be spending money. I have to spend to live. I'm gonna have to be buying clothes, I don't have to be buying food, I'm gonna have to be buying cars. So there's still gonna be spending, but I don't think we need to encourage people to spend. So that's what the current monetary system is doing. Basically, you get zero interest on saving money. What we're starting to see now over the last several years is what they're calling negative interest rates. So now the banks are actually charging you to hold your money. That's encouraging people to go spend. Why save? I don't want to save. I'm getting penalized to save. I'm going to spend it. I'm going to rack up debt. But I just don't think that's the way to do it. So that's the answer to your question, Tommy Blanchard. For more info on that, like I said, just look up Austrian Economics. Go on to YouTube, search some videos, go on to Mises Institute, get some books. Check that out. Great question. The next question is from Mikey. And Mikey said, I like your vid. I gave you a thumbs up. Thank you. Hopefully everybody does. There's one point I disagree with. Oh, here we come. One point I disagree with concerning Bitcoin is that it is not a store of value in my humble opinion, he says. It is only a decentralized fiat currency without central bank control at this point so far. There may be a day that I dip my hand in, but I'm not convinced. My question is, how long do you think central banks will allow Bitcoin and other currency outside of their control to last? So first, you disagree concerning Bitcoin that it's not a store of value at this point so far. You're not disagreeing. I actually agree with you on that point. I don't believe that Bitcoin is a good store of value yet. Money has this natural evolution. It starts as a collectible. So at one point, gold was a collectible. It wasn't money. It was just something that was pretty and it was collected and turned into jewelry. At some point, it goes from a collectible into a store of value. After enough people are using it, after enough people are starting to put their money in, it becomes a store of value. Then, once it becomes a store of value, then it naturally progresses into a medium of exchange, an MOE, and that is now money. To your point, you disagree, it's not Bitcoin isn't a store of value. I agree, right? Like I said, it's not there yet. Currently, I believe Bitcoin is in stage one. It's currently a collectible. It's an investment. It's a speculative investment. And it's working its way into number two, which will become a store of value. Eventually, once there's enough money in it, once there's enough people in it, we'll get to the store of value. And once we're past the store of value, then we'll finally move into the money stage, the MOE, the medium of exchange. The second part was, how long do I think central banks will allow Bitcoin and other currencies to exist outside of their control? That's a great question. So all the central banks of the world, their power comes from controlling the money. They are going to use every tool at their disposal to control money. What I believe, and this is a deeper topic probably for a whole separate video, is that they are going to control money as long as they can, but money as we know it is going to change forever. And a real easy way to think about this is before the internet, all information came from the newspaper or the nightly news. Today with the internet, we get information everywhere. It's all around us. My car's giving me information. My phone's giving me information. I'm getting information everywhere. And the newspapers are still there today. They're just a lot less relevant. The newspapers hunkered down and they've done everything they could to protect themselves and they're still there, but they're less relevant. And that's how I see money being. So the central banks will continue to try and control money as long as they can. It'll just become a lot less relevant. So hopefully that answers those two questions in there, Mikey. For the fourth and final question, we have Jay Will. And he said, I liked and subscribed. Thank you very much. Question though, are you diversifying how you invest in precious metals? For example, gold and silver stocks and or ETFs? Also, storing is always a pain in the butt. Do you believe in services that hold your gold for you and allow you to use prepaid cards? I know not your keys, not your Bitcoin, and the same is for gold. First of all, are you diversifying how you invest in precious metals, physical stocks, and ETFs? So there's a bunch of ways that you can invest into metals, gold, silver, palladium, whatever. You can buy the physical metal, you can hold that, and there's different types of physical. So there's coins, there's collectible coins that are worth a lot of money and could be worth a lot more. There's gold bars, things like that. So there's different types of physical. And then you can also buy stocks. So there's you can buy gold miners, you can buy their stocks. And then there's like ETFs as well. ETFs make it really easy to get exposure to the price of gold. And also it's really easy way to short gold and things like that. To answer your question, I like to take physical delivery of gold, and I also like to buy stock in gold miners. Typically, when the gold prices go up, gold miners can go up exponentially. So there, a lot of times, are going to be a much better return on your investment than the gold itself. However, risk and reward, the reward is higher. There's also more risk as well. They're more volatile. Typically, I stay away from ETFs. They can be used for more complex strategies, like I mentioned, but I typically don't do that. So hopefully that answers your question. Now for the second part, about storing the gold and your reference to Bitcoin and not your keys, not your coin. So what that means is if you don't own it, if you don't have custody of it, then you don't own it. So what that really means is that legally, the money in your bank is not yours anymore. Now the bank has that. They owe you the money, but it's not your money. With gold, I can choose to custody, store it myself, or I could choose to have someone hold it for me, or with Bitcoin, same, I could hold the key, or I could have a company hold that for me. Now, pros and cons for each. If I don't trust the bank with my money, I can hold it myself, but is my security good? Same with gold. I could store the physical gold myself. If I have a couple of coins, a few thousand dollars worth, $10,000, $20,000 worth, am I okay with that? Is my safe okay? If I have $1 million worth of gold or $10 million worth of gold, do I really want to keep that at my house? At that point, I probably would want to have a third-party service, a safety deposit box at a bank, or a special gold custody service. Same with Bitcoin. If you have a few thousand dollars, even a few hundred thousand dollars, maybe that's okay with a hardware wallet at home. If you're having millions or hundreds of millions of dollars, you probably want to have a third-party service. It depends on the amount you have and then what you're using, how you're using a storage company to do that. So they each have their own risk and reward. I would say for a small amount, custody it yourself. For large amounts, have someone else custody it for you. So hopefully that answers your question. And that's it. That's all the questions that we're going to answer for today. Make sure to leave your comments and questions down below. Thumbs up if you like these. Thumbs down if you don't. Give me your feedback so I know what to do for the next one. And leave your comments so we can pull your question for the next video. That's it. To your success. I'm out.